the love, the mystery. Your mercy covers me, your grace is
my. Hallelujah. Tonight I'm going to say some things I've probably not taught before, but things that I've believed for a long time. I'm doing a series, as you know, on why I'm not a Roman Catholic. This is part two. And I want to speak tonight about one of the reasons that I'm not a Roman Catholic is because of the Pope. Not this particular Pope. I mean, I'm sure this particular Pope's a nice guy in his own way. But it's nothing to do with personality. Why I'm not a Roman Catholic is because of what the Pope teaches about himself. And as I've been studying this, I found out there's a whole lot more to this series that I want to bring. So I'm not even sure how long we will be tonight, but I want to speak somewhat about the Pope. Last time, I said Rome is guilty of preaching another Jesus, and they preach it by another spirit, and they proclaim another gospel. Of course, our text was 2 Corinthians chapter 11, and verse 4, where we find out there's another Jesus, another spirit, another gospel. That word another Jesus is allos in the Greek, which means another of the same kind. Then there's a heterospirit, which is another of a different kind, and the heteros gospel. And it's my belief that in its refusal to submit to the word of God, the Bible, as its supreme authority in matters of faith, that the Roman communion worships another Jesus, and they have another spirit, and they have another gospel. And why was that? It's because they do not follow what we call the doctrine of sola scriptura. The Bible is our rule of faith. If we establish it from the Bible, then that's fine. That's wonderful. We are in submission to the Bible. Why do we read the Word on a Sunday morning publicly? We read the Word because it says to read the Word. Why do we sing? Because it says singing. It talks about singing in your hearts to the Lord, making melody in your hearts with singing with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Where do we find preaching? Why do we have preaching? It's in the Scripture. The Scripture tells us how to order our service. There are some variations that some people see, but they're basically things that go by the Scripture. Why do we believe what we believe? Because the Bible tells us so. How do we believe the gospel? It's the Bible. And it's not what some pope says. It's not what some seer says, some prophet says, who's outside of the Bible. It's the Bible. And the scriptures of the Old and New Testament are sufficient to guide us into how we may glorify God and enjoy him forever, if I may just paraphrase some of the shorter catechism. And we discovered last night in their refusal to bend their knee or bow their hearts before the Scripture, they've taken Mary. Mary, what a beautiful woman. The mother of our Lord. Obedient servant. Who cried out and said, my spirit does rejoice in God, my Savior. Which is the language of any sinner. She says about Jesus, whatever he says, do it. What a wonderful woman. And what have they done to her? Well, they've made her into a kind of a goddess. And we can pray to her. And she will guide you with her prayers into glory, as it were. And they teach that she is sinless, that she never sinned, and that she was conceived immaculately. Just the same way Christ was conceived immaculately, she was conceived immaculately. Where do they get that in the Bible? They don't. They make it up as they go along. Some council, some pope says this and that. And then, and that's another series we have to look at, is sola scriptura, the authority of the word of God as compared to the authority of tradition. And so they say she remained a perpetual virgin, even though we clearly saw last week that there were brothers and sisters that Jesus had. And she was then taken body, soul, and spirit into heaven, where she lives and mediates for us. And back in 1854, Pope Pius IX established the dogma of the Immaculate Conception. 1854, that's not too long ago. Well, in other words, that wasn't found in the Bible. Some pope made it up, Pope Pius IX, and he came up with this Immaculate Conception of Mary, and in other words, they teach that she was preserved from original sin. And here's what this man said about her. He said, "Let all the children of the Catholic Church who are so very dear to us hear these words of ours." Now, this is the Pope speaking about Mary. "With a still more ardent zeal for piety, religion, and love, let them continue to venerate, invoke, and pray to the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, conceived without original sin. Let them fly with utter confidence to this most sweet Mother of mercy and grace in all dangers, difficulties, needs, doubts, and fears, under her guidance and under her patronage, under her kindness and protection, nothing is to be feared, nothing is hopeless, because while bearing towards us a truly motherly affection and having in our care the work of our salvation, she is solicitous about the whole human race, and since she has been appointed by God to be the Queen of Heaven and the Queen of Earth, and is exalted above all the choirs of angels and saints, and even stands at the right hand of her only begotten Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and she presents our petitions in a most efficacious manner, and what she asks, she obtains. Her pleas can never be unheard." Do you see why I say they preach another gospel? And again, if God spurs us, we'll get into more detail on that. Why are you preaching this series, Brother Miles? I'll tell you one of the reasons. I am so fed up with meeting evangelical Christians, they say, who defend Rome left, right, and center, and saying, no, they're a Christian church. They're a Christian church. While not realizing what Rome teaches. And how can you, one week, I mentioned them last week, the Bubba and Herschel letters. I read through them again today, and they give you a good summary of why you would never tolerate somebody who claimed the claims of the Roman church. You would run them out of town. You would say that is apostasy, that is awful blasphemy. But yet there's so many so-called Christians running, hug the priests, and hey, listen, I'm all for being nice to the priest. And all, yes, that's not the point. I'm talking about the system of religion which has exalted itself against God. But anyway, I want to give you tonight the second reason why I'm not a Roman Catholic, and that is the Pope. You can mistake in somebody's identity. Did you know that? You can make somebody higher than they're supposed to be. Do you remember how after his prophetic vision in the glories of heaven, just right at the end of the book of Revelation, the Apostle John, this would be Revelation 22, verses 8 to 9. Revelation 22, 8 to 9. Well, he described how he was overwhelmed by what he saw. And he says, "And when I heard and saw, I fell down to worship at the feet of the angel who showed me these things. But he said to me, Don't do that. I am a fellow servant of you and your brethren, the prophets, and of those who heed the words of God. Worship God." So John had mistaken him as being God, an angel. And the guy says, "No, I'm just a fellow servant. I only worship God." And so John committed an error. And you know what? Romanism has committed the same error. They think that there's a certain someone who has more glory and honor than he actually has. And he's the guy who we call the Bishop of Rome. He's called the Pope. That's his name. The Pontiff, the Pope, all the same idea. And so before the Reformation, have you ever heard of a guy called John Huss? I recommend folks, we read biographies. You can find a biography on John Huss anywhere online, H-U-S-S. He was a Bohemian Christian, and he wrote a book in English. It's called The Church. He writes about the church. This is 100 years before the Reformation. And in chapter 4 of this book, in fact, just by the way, I remember years ago, I saw, they made a movie about this guy, John Huss. Tremendous man. Chapter 4 of his book on the church, the title of the chapter was Christ, the Only Head of the Church. Now, there isn't a soul listening to me or watching this tonight that wouldn't say, amen. Christ is the head of the church. Here's what he wrote, part of what he wrote. He said, neither is the Pope the head, nor are the cardinals the whole body of the whole holy universal Catholic Church, i.e. the true church, for Christ alone is the head of the church, pointing out that most of the church leaders in this era actually despised the lordship of Christ. He was arguing that you're despising Christ if you say that the Pope is the head of the church. It's Christ who's the head of the church. And he said, to such a low pitch is the clergy come, they hate those who preach often and call Jesus Christ Lord. And you say, how could that be? Well, here's how it is. Do you know what Rome did to this man for saying this? They declared him to be a heretic. And they burnt him at the stake in the year 1415. I was reading up on this, and he was taken to the cathedral in Prague, and he was dressed in his priestly clothing. Remember, this was a Roman Catholic priest. But what he was a gospel preacher. And he was preaching the doctrines of the Bible, the salvation by grace alone. And he was preaching all these different things. But he's dressed as a priest. And when they arrived in public view, he was stripped of all his priestly garments, one garment at a time. And then he was tied to the stake, at which point he prayed, Lord Jesus, it is for you that I patiently endure this cruel death. Have mercy on my enemies. And he was heard reciting the Psalms as the flames engulfed him. And his executioners were so desirous of ridding the earth of every bit of the man that they actually, after the execution, they scooped up his ashes and they threw them in the river so that he wouldn't have any place where there would just be nothing of John Huss remaining. Now, some of the people who revered him, who loved his preaching, collected bits of dirt from the spot where he died, and they took them back to Bohemia for a memorial. Who instructed that this man should be treated this way? The Pope. Why? Because his headship over the church was challenged, not by Huss, but by Huss's statement that Jesus Christ was the head of the church. Folks, you see how far off you can get from the Bible? How far off, if you don't take the Bible as your authority, how far off you can get? 100 years later, by the way, there's a man comes along who also challenges the papal establishment. His name was Martin Luther, and he read this book called The Church. And after finishing the book, he wrote to a friend that says, I have hitherto taught and held all opinions of John Huss, and I didn't know. I was unaware that I held exactly what he held. And he said, so did John Stoppus, who was another reformer. He said, in short, we are all Hussites without knowing it. That's the great reformer Luther, 100 years later. Now, Rome claims that the Pope is the head of the church. Right there, I cannot become a part of that. I cannot cozy up to that. I love my Lord Jesus too much to do that. I respect and honor him too much to say, oh yeah, we're all together in this. And they just, somebody will say, oh, sure, there's no perfect church. No, there's no perfect church, but I will not fellowship with the priests. I've been asked to go to ecumenical meetings and all like that there. I refuse to do it. Why? Because of my honor for the Lord Jesus Christ. What's the Bible teach about the headship of the church? Colossians 1:18, let's try this one. And he, Jesus, is the head of the body, the church. Wow. You see, if you don't have the Bible as your authority, you can get into making somebody the head of the church. Oh, but isn't the Queen of England the head of the church? Well, yeah, that's true, and that I think that's wrong, but at least this headship, she's not as seriously in error as Rome is, and you're going to see the error that they promote through saying that the Pope is the head of the church. He is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence. He is to have the preeminence, not the Pope. The Pope isn't the man, the main man. Ephesians 5:23. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and he is the savior of the body. Old Spurgeon said it like this: the church of God in a very special manner calls Jesus our Lord, for there is not and there cannot be any head of the church other than the Lord Jesus Christ. It's an awful blasphemy for any man on earth to call himself Christ, a vicar, and head of the church. It is a usurping of the crown rights of the Lord Jesus, or for any king or queen to be called the head of the church, for the true church of Jesus Christ can have no head but Jesus Christ himself. And I'm thankful there is no head of the church of which I'm a member except Jesus Christ. Amen. Who's the head of your church? It's Jesus. Who's the leader of your church? Jesus. He's the head. He's alive. How can he not lead his church? He's alive. He rose from the dead. He's alive forevermore. He's seated in cosmic authority, and he's the head of the church. His church. He bought his church with his own blood. He has the right to be the head of the church. Well, the Pope says, nope, I'm the head of the church. And he uses a series of divine titles to show that he's the head of the church. Did you know he's called the Holy Father? Well, why don't you check it out and read the Gospel of John, or I'll read chapter 17 and see Jesus in prayer. And he talks to the Father and calls him Holy Father. Thou Holy Father. And yet the Pope says he's the Holy Father. Well, which one is it? Is it God or is it the Pope? Which is the Holy Father? How would you call him the Holy Father when that's a divine title? Well, you say he surely that he doesn't mean to say there's anything divine about him. Oh, interesting. Do you know what else he calls himself? He calls himself the Vicar of Christ. Look that up on the internet. The Vicar of Christ. Now, vicar means substitute. Comes, we get our word, the same root, we get the word vicarious. Substitution. Jesus has a substitute now on earth. Who? While Jesus is in heaven, he does things through his substitute. Who's the substitute? The Pope. That's what they teach. He is the vicar of Christ. Very, very interesting. And so Jesus says, John 14:15-16, where he's claiming about, or he's talking about, he has to go away, but he says, I'll send another comforter. I'll come to you in this comforter. Who's the substitute for Jesus on earth? Do you know who it was? The Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the vicar of Christ, not the Pope of Rome. Then he calls himself the supreme pontiff. Pontiff is defined in the dictionary as pope, high priest, bishop. And the title supreme pontiff really means the great high priest. I have a whole message on the great high priest, and I may well bring that as part of the series. Who's the great high priest in the Bible? Is it the Pope or is it Jesus? I don't think we'll take time to look at them, but you can see Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 14, Hebrews chapter 8 and verse 1, Hebrews chapter 10, verse 21. That's Hebrews 4:14, 8:1, 10:21. You'll see that Jesus is the high priest, not the Pope. But the Pope says, no, he's the supreme pontiff. And within that idea of not only being the chief bishop, the chief priest, there comes an idea of the chief shepherd of the flock. But yet Peter very clearly, 1 Peter 2:25, and then chapter 5 and verse 4, says that Jesus is the shepherd, the chief shepherd, the good shepherd, or the great shepherd. But none of this should surprise us. Let me tell you what the Pope has taught about himself, or others have taught in authority in Rome about the Pope. And as I said at the beginning, I haven't taught on this stuff. I've known about it and believed in it. And I, you know, but I'm now vocalizing it. And I hope people who hear this on sermon audio or YouTube will pass it on, because there is a plague before us, a plague before us, where there's a capitulation to Romanism. Just last year, two of the leading television evangelists went over and met with them. No, more than two. There was three or four of them went over. They all high-fived each other. These would be people who are household names. Isn't this new Pope just wonderful? Isn't he lovely? And yes, he comes across as lovely, and meek and mild. Yeah, I'm not saying that. But what he stands for, and what he teaches, is lethal poison. But there's a lot of good with it. He's against abortion. You know, Jim Jones, I don't know if you ever heard of him. Anybody from America would have heard of him. But he took people down to Guyana, or wherever it's called, down in South America. And started a colony, had 1,000 people. And he killed them all. He had them all to commit suicide. He gave them all coolaid and put poison in it. And when somebody says, well, there's a lot of good about the Pope, what they remind me of is saying, yeah, a lot of good in his poison. The good that he does is Kool-Aid, but the doctrine he holds is poison, and it's lethal, and it will destroy you. You want to hear some of the things that they've claimed? This is from Robert Cardinal Bellarmine, who was in the 1500s. You'll see him in the Counter-Reformation and fighting the corner. He was one of the chief men. He says, all the names in which in the scripture are applied to Christ, by virtue of which it is established that he is over the church, all the same names are applied to the Pope. Every title of Christ is the Pope's. Because the scripture says Christ is head of the church, but the Pope is head of the church. So therefore he has all of Christ's titles. That has never been repented of. They have never come out and said, we are sorry we said that. Then, will you hear this, of a description of a happening on April the 29th in 1922. And I have the sources and everything. But in the Vatican throne room, a throng of cardinals, bishops, priests, nuns, boys and girls were all falling on their knees in reverence of the one, the Pope, who was in front of them. And the Pope, who was Pope Pius XI, addressed them. And he said, you know that I am the Holy Father, the representative of God on the earth, the vicar of Christ, which means I am God on the earth. It's never been repented of. I am God on the earth. Some people wonder why I don't run hand in hand to ecumenical things with Roman Catholic priests and bishops. I am God on the earth. Repent of that and start preaching the gospel. Here's another one. It's from Ferraris, an Italian Catholic canonist and consultor of the Holy Office in Rome. He says, the Pope is of such great dignity and so exalted that he is not a mere man. The Pope is not a mere man, but as it were, God. You don't believe? I mean, you can't make this stuff up. This is incredible. He is the divine, he is, as it were, but as it were, God and the vicar of God. He is the divine monarch, the supreme emperor, and king of kings. Bet you didn't know it was this bad. Here's another one. Pope Leo the 13th. We hold upon this earth the place of God Almighty. There's the Pope. Another problem I have with the Pope is this. Catholic dogma asserts that the Pope is the pastor of the universal church on earth, and that he is a full and supreme jurisdiction over the whole church. If you want to be in the real church, you need to be in his church. They recently, just a couple of years ago, said people like us were beyond the pale. But if you were friendly towards them, they could include you. They would say, okay, we had a split away in the Reformation, but we welcome everybody back, and you're all part of the right church then. So he's the pastor of the universal church on earth. And so the church, according to them, is the church that is governed by the successors of Peter and the bishops in communion with him. And Christians who do not acknowledge the Pope's authority over them are separated. And in fact, it gets worse than that. As one of these days, we'll look at the Council of Trent and see what they say about people who believe the gospel. Did you know that they send us to hell? They consign us to hell. They anathematize us for believing in justification by grace through faith. And yet people want to run to them? No. It's also claimed by the Pope that he is infallible on matters of faith when he speaks in what is called ex cathedra. That doesn't mean every day he says something that's infallible. It's just when he makes a pronouncement on doctrine. It's infallible. If he rules on faith and morals, it's infallible. Papal infallibility is not an old teaching. It's quite a new teaching. It happened in the 1800s, right before the Vatican I. Not Vatican II, Vatican I. The First Vatican Council in the 19th century. And it defined papal infallibility. And right before that, the Roman Catholic Church had denied papal infallibility. But then, when it came along to Vatican II, they defined and claimed papal infallibility. And they said, no, it's always been this way throughout church history. And yet, the Catholic Catechism, before Vatican I, denied it. And so the problem with the Pope is he's not ruled by the Bible. He can make pronouncements which have equal and more authority than the Bible. It doesn't matter what the Bible says. It's what the Pope says. Doesn't matter what the Bible says, it's what the church says. It's what the faith says. The leaders say. So it's not a matter of being a Bible-based. They say, okay, read the Bible. Yes, read the Bible, but you know this, you can't understand the Bible. You need the church to interpret the Bible for you. And so the Bible has very little authority in the Pope's eyes. Now, I'm going to tell you this. The reformers, Luther, Calvin, the boys, understood the errors of Rome and preached against them with a holy boldness. Martin Luther said to a friend, wrote to a friend and said, now Owen, this may shock you. We here are of the conviction that the papacy is the seat of the true and real Antichrist. The papal office, the seat of the real and true Antichrist. And all reformers taught this. And all the preachers that came in each generation, George Whitefield, preached that the Pope and the papal office were Antichrist. Pope would be the man of sin, the office of the Pope, the papal authority, Antichrist. They preached, it was preached from the times of the Reformation. And then I think I'll have to do a separate teaching on the history of where we got this idea that Antichrist was going to be a future event. That only came in the 1500s after what is called the Counter-Reformation, which was, there were two things that the Jesuits, the protectors of the papacy, did. Number one, they came up with a thing called preterism, which said, no, the Antichrist happened in the past. That was Nero. The other, that didn't really take on, but there was another guy, I think his name was Ribera. And I'll teach on this sometime. But he said, no, everything after Revelation 7 is future, and the Antichrist is future. It can't be the Pope. It's future. Nobody believed this. Nobody on the Protestant side believed this. Until the 1800s, when it was reintroduced by a group of people called the Catholic, I can't remember their name. Alexander Irvine was the man. Catholic Apostolic Church. And they had this by a prophetic trance from a wee girl. And she gave a prophetic trance and she said all this stuff. And that the church was going to be raptured and taken out 7 years before the Lord would come back and all of that. Nobody believed that. Except a little obscure sect. And then the Plymouth Brethren got a hold of it. And they began to preach it. And they were so successful preaching it that a man called Scofield came along and put it in his notes. Scofield Bible. And from then on, everybody and their granny believed that. To whereby today, if you say that the Pope is and the papacy is so anti-gospel they are the Antichrist, people look at you like you've got two heads. Now, I'm not asking you to believe it. I'm just telling you the way I see it. Now, why would the reformers, have had any Bible for this? Well, try this. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 3 to 4. 2 Thessalonians 2, 3 to 4. The Apostle Paul is describing the coming Antichrist. He says, let no man deceive you by any means. For that day shall not come except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who, listen to this description, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God, or that is worshipped, so that he asks God, sits in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. And what has the Pope done? He claims to be the head of the church, which is the temple, and he claims he is equal with God. He is God on earth. We have a perfect description of the papacy and what it has done in 2 Thessalonians 2, 3 to 4. The Presbyterians have a thing called the Westminster Confession of Faith, and they say this: there can be no other head of the church than the Lord Jesus Christ, nor can the Pope of Rome in any sense be the head of it. But is that, here's what they say about him, but is that Antichrist, the man of sin, the son of perdition, that exalts himself in the church against Christ and all that is called God? Okay, but it's only the Westminster Confession. What does the Bible say? Well, the Bible says in 1 John 2:18 that the Antichrist has been here since the first century. Little children, it's the last time, says this 1 John 2:18. And as you've heard, that Antichrist shall come. And even now there are many Antichrists. Whereby we know it is the last time. So the Antichrist has been here since the beginning, the first century. And the Antichrist will still be here when Jesus Christ returns. Let's see 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. I will read it to you. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Verses 8 to 12. And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. Even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all powers, signs, and lying wonders, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they received not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. And for this cause God shall send them a strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but have pleasure in unrighteousness. That is frightening. Have you ever read it? No. Well, take it back home and read it. And meditate upon it. Wow. Yep. Therefore, since the Antichrist was there and the Antichrist is yet to come, it cannot be a single personality. No single personality exists for 2,000 years. But the Antichrist was there in year not, you know, year 100, year whatever, 90, and is yet to come. So the Antichrist must be an office or a position of authority. They teach nowadays that the Antichrist will occupy the temple of Jerusalem. No, he won't. There's not going to be another temple in Jerusalem. Oh, no, brother, it's going to... No, it's not. God's not... Why? God's not going to bless the apostasy of building another temple and reinstating blood sacrifice. What's the cross all about? We don't need any more blood sacrifice. Christ has suffered once. Doesn't need to suffer again. So this idea that God's going to send a bunch of people in to build a temple, it's fantasy, and it's anti-gospel. It won't happen. But Antichrist is an office, or a position of authority. And he is presently appearing in what is called the body of Christ, the universal church. And he has exalted himself already. He calls himself God. And he claims dominion over every other believer. He claims authority over every other believer. Do you remember the office of the Inquisition? Did you know it still exists? They don't call it that. They call it something like the Congregation for the Doctrine of, or the Congregation for the Faith, or I'll look it up, but it's still there. In fact, the previous pope was the head of it, head of the modern-day Inquisition. They claim authority over your conscience if you claim to be Christian. Now, you talk about exalting yourself in the house of God. There's only one possibility that can fulfill the prophecies, and the pope and the papal system is the one position that fulfills all of these scriptural prophecies. And by the way, I want you to be Bereans. Go and study this out. Don't be believing this because Miles said it. Study this out. But above all, avoid being an ecumenist when it comes to Rome. Yeah. Hug the neck of believers who are in different, you know, there's Baptists, there's Presbyterians, whatever, they're saved people. Saved people are saved people. We're all one. We might have a few distinctions. We're all one. Yeah, I love Roman Catholics and everything like that, but I will not say I'm one with the local priest. And I won't go to functions with him to represent. I've been invited to those things, left, right, and center. A few years ago, I was invited to a boat blessing. The vicar and the priest and some bishop and all. I'm not going to go to that kind of stuff. But anyway, Roman Catholics see the Pope as the vicar of Christ. Now, did you know that the word Antichrist, by the way, remember vicar means substitute, the vicar? Antichrist. Anti, that little word anti, simply means in place of. We think it means against. It is against, but it's in place of. Antichrist means in place of Christ. And the bishop, and the Pope of Rome, the Bishop of Rome says he is the vicar of Christ, in place of Christ. Antichrist is in place of Christ, and the vicar of Christ means in place of Christ. And right there, by their own definition, they define themselves, when he calls himself the vicar of Christ, he defines himself as the Antichrist, in place of Christ. And so, Jesus is the head of the church. And Jesus is alive, and he's involved with his church, and he instructs the church through the word, and the Spirit of God will, as you read the word, Spirit of God will make it alive and speak to you and quicken you. And we don't need this Pope to be telling us and ruling us and saying, I say it, therefore it's true. I speak ex cathedra, and it doesn't matter what the Bible says, and you can't understand it anyway. No, I'll never become a Roman Catholic with that kind of teaching. I indeed now worship the Lord Jesus Christ, and he is the head of the church. And the word of God tells me that therefore God has highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven, things on earth, and things under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. What is every tongue to confess? They're to confess, will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Lord means the Kyrios, the one in total charge. He's in charge of his church, not the Pope. The Pope is a usurper, a trespasser. He has no business claiming the things he claims. And so when we say Jesus is the head of the church, we simply say we bow before him. We bend our knee before him. We worship him. He is our sovereign. He is our ruler. He's the one who said, all authority is given unto me in heaven and on earth. And that is the gospel truth this evening. Amen.
The love, the mystery.
We hope you enjoyed today's message. For more information about our ministry, go to milesmckee.com. Our church website is thegracechurch.ie. We'd love to hear from you. Miles's email is miles@thegracechurch.ie. If you'd like to support the work we are doing in Ireland and other parts of the world, you can click on the donate link on milesmckee.com. Don't forget to check out more sermons at sermonaudio.com. Until next time, slán agus beannacliv.
Never have enough. Your perfect peace, your word of truth. I am here broken, giving everything to you.